Good afternoon. My name is Carlin Bowman, and I'm a senior fellow here at AEI, and I'd like to welcome all of you to this American Enterprise debate, Is the Republican Party Too Extreme? One of the first things that I learned in coming to AEI many, many years ago was the Institute's mission statement, 10 simple words. The competition of ideas is fundamental to a free society. With this slogan, AEI's president, William J. Broody, did not simply mean that we valued competition among various institutions in Washington, though of course we do. He was equally at home with and he championed, as his successors, Krista Muth and Arthur Brooks have done, spirited debates within the AEI family. Within the halls of AEI, we've had many such debates. To name just a few, our scholars have differed strongly over antitrust policy, and particularly the wisdom of the Microsoft case. Those of a more conservative bent have disagreed with libertarians over many issues, including abortion, gay marriage, and even euthanasia. They've differed on the wisdom of organ donation. Scholars here have publicly sparred over the merits of a carbon tax. There were disagreements about the Iraq War, and about democracy promotion. In the fall, AEI will publish a book on competing views of China's rise. Scholars have even differed with one another about the merits of plastic bags. The debates have always been vigorous and always civil. Our debate tonight on whether the Republican Party is too extreme is very much in keeping with that history. I'd like to acknowledge the work of Daniel Hansen and Laurie Sanders, who worked so hard to make this series a success. Our speakers are well known to you, and the biographical material is available to you on the AEI website. Norm Ornstein is a resident scholar and a longtime observer of Congress and politics. His columns and roll call are must-reads on Capitol Hill. Steve Hayward is the F.K. Weyerhaeuser Fellow at AEI, an important presidential biographer, and a regular blogger for Powerline on politics. We're very fortunate to have Stu Rothenberg as our moderator tonight. Stu is the editor and publisher of the Rothenberg Political Report, an invaluable newsletter covering House, Senate, and presidential campaigns and political developments. He writes about this twice a week for a roll call, always with an even-handed tone, perfect for our moderator. Stu.
Thank you, Carlin. It's a pleasure to be here for this interesting debate. I feel like I'm the Jocko Conlin of intellectuals. If you don't know who Jocko Conlin is, you'll have to look it up. Try Wikipedia. I am here to give you the rules, and then I will leave the stage to these two gentlemen, and I'll be back for the Q&A. It's pretty simple. We'll begin with 8-minute opening statements by each of our combatants, followed by 5-minute rebuttals by each, a 27-minute, I don't know who figured this out, it's not 26 or 28, but it will be 27 minutes of Q&A or a free-for-all or whatever, followed by 5-minute closing statements by each gentleman. We will be taking questions via email and Twitter. For those of you so inclined, the Twitter handle is #AEIDebates. You can tweet your questions to that. And the email is AEIDebates@AEI.org. At the end of each round, there'll be a buzzer or a bell or or that, which will sound the end of the round. And I will be back in a bit to moderate the questions. So now, 8 minutes each opening round, followed by 5 minutes each rebuttals. Gentlemen, begin. Norm?
Okay, I'll start. Thanks so much, Stu. And
I'm already crushed.
Okay. Thank you, Stu and Carlin, and thank you all for coming. This debate was really precipitated by an Washington Post Outlook piece that my co-author Tom Mann and I did, keyed to our new book, It's Even Worse Than It Looks, which, by the way, makes a great holiday gift. I want to start by thanking my friend and opponent, Steve Hayward, but I also want to give profuse thanks to Jeb Bush, an AEI favorite, who said today that both Ronald Reagan and his father would have a difficult time getting nominated by today's ultra-conservative Republican Party, commenting disapprovingly as he did on, quote, an orthodoxy that doesn't allow for disagreement, doesn't allow for finding some common ground. Thank you for your impeccable timing, Jeb. I want to also thank Alan West, Richard Murdoch, Ted Nugent, Herman Cain, Donald Trump, Michelle Bachmann, the 237 House Republicans, and 90% of Senate Republicans who have signed the Norquist No Tax Pledge, and too many more to name for making my task so much easier. After all these thank yous, I'm tempted to do a Sally Field and say, you like me, you really like me, but surveying this audience, no. So on to the debate topic. Is the Republican Party too extreme? And I'm going to talk quickly because I've got a lot of things to say and evidence to provide, and 8 minutes isn't a lot. I won't talk as quickly as my son who did policy debate where you blurt things out, but I'll elide over some things. Let me start by emphasizing what I will not be saying. I will not say one party is good and the other is evil. There are no angels here. Sharp partisanship and hardball politics are normal, and both parties often will edge up to the line and sometimes go over. I will not say that all Republicans are extreme. Many, including some very strong conservatives, want to solve problems and find common ground where they can. And I will not say that it is conservatism that is extreme. Ronald Reagan, Jeb Bush, Bob Bennett, Bob Inglis, Chuck Hagel, Mitch Daniels, Mickey Edwards, to name a few of many, are plenty conservative and not extreme. Now, I'm going to suggest that a party can be extreme in three ways, and I will discuss each: tactics, ideology, and rhetoric. First, tactics, and I should emphasize here that tactics do depend on context. I posit that the GOP has adopted a set of parliamentary tactics in a non-parliamentary system in a way that is unlike any we have seen before, underscoring some of Jeb Bush's points: purely oppositional and obstructionist, disdaining problem solving, defining its partisan adversary as the enemy, and opposing positions often because of who is supporting them, not because of what is in them. Now, the first evidence comes from the filibuster. Let me put up a chart. Which is now being applied in a fashion unseen in all of previous American history. I don't have time to go over the history of the filibuster. Much of it is in the book. Did I mention it makes a great holiday gift? But let me say that in the past, filibusters were used rarely for an issues of great national moment by a minority feeling intensely about them and willing to stop everything and throw themselves into making their point. Now it is used routinely as a weapon of obstruction. Cloture motions were roughly two a month in the 1970s, three a month in the 1980s. Now there are two or more a week. Now I have to say, to be sure, that the minority has a point here. Many cloture motions are filed prematurely. They're designed to shut off the minority's ability to debate an issue. That's true, and it's a chicken and egg question here, but it doesn't explain multiple filibusters on bills and nominations that garner unanimous or near unanimous support. Some examples: the Workers, Homeowners, and Business Assistant Act, two filibusters, it passed 98 to nothing, but it took 4 weeks and seven full days of floor time. The Credit Card Holders Bill of Rights, also 90 to 5, 7 days of floor time. The Fraud Enforcement and Recovery Act on mortgage and securities fraud, 92 to 4 on passage, 6 days of floor time. All done simply to stretch out the time frame and take the most precious commodity of the Senate and block things from happening. The same has been true of nominations, the most prominent being Court of Appeals Judge Barbara Milano Keenan. 99 to nothing on a cloture vote, 99 to nothing confirmation, but filibustered and delayed for weeks in a nomination that actually took many months before it even came up. And even more striking on nominations, filibusters used for what we call the new nullification, also unprecedented, blocking people who are widely considered, even by those opposing them, as being fully qualified and passing every vetting standard, but blocked for things like the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, because the people blocking them don't like the laws that have been legally and constitutionally enacted and want to keep them from being implemented. Now, on tactics, if I had a lot of time, I could go on to talk in detail about the debt limit, used for the first time in history as a hostage to non-negotiable demands and now filling Mitch McConnell's prediction, used apparently routinely for hostage taking. Two other Washington examples of extreme tactics: the Greg Conrad Fiscal Commission, where people who had supported it and co-sponsored it voted against their own bill because they didn't want to give a victory to the other side. The same with the Bennett-Wyden health reform bill. And I want to emphasize that these sorts of tactics are not simply limited to Washington. Earlier this year, to pick one example, there was a bill sent to Pennsylvania Governor Tom Corbett to name a bridge in Irvona, Pennsylvania, after a local victim of the 9/11 attacks in New York. The Mary Ellen TAC Memorial 9/11 Bridge was adopted by the Pennsylvania House and Senate, and Governor Corbett refused to sign it, even as he accepted all other comparable bills. Why? Because it was introduced by a Democrat, State Representative Camille Bud George. Now, these tactics have been, I think, succinctly defined by Richard Murdoch, who beat Richard Lugar for the nomination for the Senate, a Republican nomination for the Senate in Indiana, and who said, among many things, "I have a mindset that says bipartisanship ought to consist of Democrats coming to the Republican point of view." Now, on ideology. In a larger sense, vote records and public opinion surveys show what's happened ideologically to the two parties in Congress. And let me just quickly put up a couple of charts that show what's happened over time in Congress to voting records for the Senate and the House. And what you'll see is clearly the Republicans in Congress are the most conservative that they have been in our lifetimes, and indeed perhaps more conservative than in a century. Democratic Party, especially as it lost its Southern Democrats, moved somewhat to the left, but nowhere near as much. Let me quote on this particular topic of ideology a prominent, maybe the most prominent and respected conservative intellectual. This kind of conservatism would be unrecognizable to, for example, Calvin Coolidge, a current sentimental conservative favorite who favored minimum wage laws and child labor regulations, or even to Reagan, who favored large-scale government science research beyond just missile defense. Recognize that quote. It came from Steve Hayward. The new Republican Party in Congress voted just recently, to pick an example, to kill the Census Bureau's annual American Community Survey and the Economic Census, which has been used by businesses for a variety of vital purposes to establish transportation routes, track inventories, pick plant sites. It's used by police departments to track crime. And just let me quote Representative Daniel Webster, who sponsored it. Of the survey, it's not scientific, it's a random survey. You can see why he's not on the Intelligence Committee. Now, I've got lots of other examples, and of course, examples on rhetoric that start with Alan West and move to many others, which we'll have to discuss during the rebuttal or other times. That's my 8 minutes.
Right. Well, I want to begin by thanking Alan Grayson, Bernie Sanders, and that Democratic state senator in Maine who recently said that Dick Cheney should be executed for war crimes. Those are the gifts that keep on giving, but that's not really how I want to start. I'll start this way. The legend is told that when conquering Roman generals would return to their victory parades in the boulevards of Rome, they would place a slave behind him to whisper in his ear, "All glory is fleeting." Well, Norm is our slave here at AEI. Although some people might use a more contemporary word beginning with a B.
Poorly paid slave, I should add.
So people ask me a lot, so what's the trick? Does Norm have naked pictures of Arthur Brooks or something? And I say, no, that wouldn't work because Arthur works out. What I tell him is that Norm is actually a very valuable presence around our hallways. He keeps us on our game. He prompts us not to confuse ideology with partisanship or to let ideology become idiocy through laziness or complacency. It's quite useful to have someone around to point out your inconsistencies and blind spots and petty hypocrisies. In other words, Norm makes all of us better here and sharper in our work, even if we sometimes mutter about his latest provocation when we leave the lunchroom. I admire much of Norm's work, seeing that his interest in the unloved Congress stems from his deep affection for the first branch. His grief at thinking it broken is sincere, his worry about its future well-founded. His work here at AEI, for example, on the continuity of government project, urging us to take prospective remedies against a worst-case terrorist strike, is of the highest value. But in contrast to the continuity of government project, I am less enamored of what I take to be his implicit continuity of liberalism project that emerges in the new book and the recent Washington Post features. And about the book, I read it and can say it is indeed even worse than it looks. Though it does make a good holiday gift, I agree with that.
Thank you.
Now, there's no doubt that we live at a time of heightened polarization, making the task of governing immensely difficult. Now, observing this unstable equilibrium, a very distinguished political scientist made the following observation, quote, "Democrats and Republicans are at the same time swaggering and uncertain, secure and paranoid. Each side is confident in its own hegemonic domain, but thrown off stride by its abject failure to extend its popularity and control to the other's turf. Each party is fearful that it will make a mistake and lose its own empire, not just for one term, but for decades. And each side is hopeful that it can finally capture its rightful complete majority by forcing the other to make the fatal mistake. But the result is passive-aggressive politics, the politics of avoiding blame. Each side is so concerned about avoiding a mistake and so intent on tarring the opposition that taking risks to make better policy is increasingly uncommon," end quote. I think that's a pretty good analytical description of the scene today, correctly perceiving the fearful symmetry of the two parties and rightly assigning equal blame to both parties. And this assessment comes from Norm Ornstein, writing back in 1990. What happened to that guy? I miss him. Was his body snatched by pod people from Planet Man? By the way, the title of that article where those words appeared was called The Permanent Democratic Congress. Maybe there's some nostalgia at work. No doubt that seems like a golden age when, as Norm put it in that article, the Republicans were reliably the Chicago Cubs of American politics. Now, according to the Manstein hypothesis, as I call it, things have changed since then, such that today Republicans are an insurgent outlier in American politics, disproportionately responsible for the problems of government that Norm has just described. They say our polarization has become asymmetric, or as they put it bluntly in the Post, it's the Republicans' fault. Now, it's passing strange to call one of the political parties an outlier when it happens to be at its highest level in terms of elected officials nationwide in 70 years. Unless you're prepared to take the next step and suggest that the American people have taken leave of their senses. Some people on the left do that. That does not appear in Norm's book. It's conspicuously absent, in fact. Although I will say that one of the odd things about the book is that you hardly notice that the election of 2010 took place. Moreover, it has to be inconvenient for the Manstein hypothesis that the Republicans didn't start winning majorities until they began the self-conscious turn to extremism that they deplore. I think some people have just never got over the 1994 election. I'll turn directly to the substance of extremism in a moment, but I want to lay down a couple of markers. Norm's charts are all very compelling on the surface, and the book does contain a catalog of genuine Republican embarrassments and hypocrisies. I think that data is susceptible to alternative explanations, but more to the point, is it really true that the partisanship of Republicans today is different in character than the kind of partisanship that led Tip O'Neill to forbid House Democrats to cooperate with Republicans on Social Security reform during Reagan's first term, or the same position taken by Hill Democrats in George W. Bush's second term when he proposed entitlement reform? Is the Republican harassment and obstruction of nominees no more frequent? Is it fundamentally different than the way Democrats used the oversight process to harass Reagan appointees in the 1980s when they didn't agree with the policies that the agencies were trying to promote? That extended in occasions to eliminating salaries and budget appropriations or cutting program funds for long-established programs. Now, we could waste a lot of time debating whose political calipers are more finely tuned to make these kind of discriminations, but I think it's ultimately quite futile to argue in a so's-your-old-man mode. I think we can dispense with the balance sheet and move directly to the sneaky presumptions embedded in the Manstein hypothesis that I think wither into nothingness when the veil is torn away. Take, for example, the view expressed in the book that the Democratic Party is, quote, more ideologically centered and diverse, and is a status quo party, quote, protective of the government's role as it has developed over the course of the last century. Now, it seems to me it doesn't take an extremist to say that's precisely the problem. Let me see if I got this right. The Democratic Party is the status quo party until they get the opportunity to ratchet up the state in a big way, which has been the story of most of the last century, after which they sit back and protect the new status quo. And Republicans are supposed to be just fine with this? This is base stealing that would astound Ricky Henderson. They further argue that, quote, the culture and ideological center of the Republican Party must change if U.S. democracy is to regain its health. What this amounts to is saying that the Republican Party should return to its historic role as of the last century of playing the Washington Generals to the Democratic Party's Harlem Reform Trotters, as I call them, or a return to the kind of accommodating moderation that prompted the great Eugene McCarthy to say that the principal use of moderate Republicans is to shoot the wounded after the battle is over. I suspect that the Manstein ideal of good government would be President David Gergen. So to the question, is the Republican Party extreme? I can only answer, I certainly hope so. Let us recall that the Republican Party began its life as an extremist party, dedicated to the purpose of abolishing the twin relics of barbarism, polygamy, and slavery. Within a year of its founding, the Republican Party was, the Supreme Court declared the Republican Party's platform to be unconstitutional. The Republican Party Manstein wishes we had would have said, oh, well, I guess we should accommodate ourselves to the status quo. Likewise, today, there's little reason or purpose for the Republican Party unless it acts with a new determination to call a decisive halt to the endless ratcheting expansion of centralized government power and reckless spending. Now, the Manstein hypothesis is no doubt successful in gaining prominent placements in the Post and in procuring adoration from Daily Show audiences, but I'd remind Norm of one thing. All glory is fleeting.
Okay, let me first say your first minute and a half, Steve, I don't disagree with a thing that you said. Let me next say that I don't know which is more disorienting to me, picturing naked pictures of Arthur Brooks or David Gergen as president. They're both about on the same par. Now let me move on to some of your arguments. When I wrote that piece in 1990, and by the way, I noted at that point that what would likely end the Democratic majority that was then moving up towards 38 years would be a Democratic president and the counterpoint that would take place. But things have changed since 1990. And indeed, many of the arguments that I would make here, and I want to go back to where I started, that neither party is an angel here. Both have often crossed lines and done things that are deplorable. And I, in the past, have condemned the Democrats for the way they handled the Bork Supreme Court nomination, blocking Miguel Estrada, statements by people like Alan West or Cynthia McKinney. Steve wrote earlier when we singled out Alan West, who said, you will recall, that between 79 and 81 Democrats in the House are members of the Communist Party. And he wrote, well, what about Cynthia McKinney? I don't remember the Democrats condemning her. So I just went back and looked, and we have this faulty timer. I got a whole bunch of newspaper and other clippings. Democratic leader condemns McKinney. Democrats get distance from McKinney. So there are differences here on that front. But more significantly is so much of this is a matter of degree and not kind, but also some of the unprecedented things that I've mentioned. If we want to look at blocking nominations, I can show you chart after chart of the number of nominations blocked compared to what we had in the Reagan years and the swiftness with which executive and judicial appointments went through. If we want to talk about cooperating with the president instead of drawing lines in the dust, I look at just two points of comparison. When George W. Bush came into the White House, in a White House that was at that point in tatters almost. We'd had the most controversial election, at least in our lifetimes, if not in American history. You had a president who had no coattails, 36 days to come in, facing an adversarial environment. It would have been very easy for Democrats to hold a dinner meeting on inaugural eve and say the way that we can really regain power is to stomp on his neck and never let up, a vote against everything that he wants and block him, and his presidency will die a boring. Instead, they cooperated immediately on No Child Left Behind with George Miller and Ted Kennedy, and that gave him a victory that established the legitimacy of his presidency, whether you like the substance or not. Democratic votes provided the margin for the tax cuts, like those or not, that were a hallmark of the Bush presidency. Democrats saved the votes on the TARP program, like it or not, that saved the Bush presidency. Now contrast that with what we now know from another book, Robert Draper's, about the meeting that took place with top Republican leaders on inaugural eve in 2009, a president who came in a landslide with a 70% approval rating and the worst economy since the Great Depression. We're going to vote against everything and make the victories look so ugly that it will delegitimize it all. I think that's a difference. And I think when you look at things like blocking nominations that are widely acceptable because you don't want bills to be implemented, that's a difference. Now let me address for just a second the argument that you made, that our colleague Peter Wallison made in print when he said that Tom and I had lost our marbles, and that how could a party be extreme if it wins elections and continues to win elections? Well, let's think of some examples in history of parties that were very extreme and won elections. Now, Peter is old enough to remember the 1930s. In fact, he's very, very old. He's perhaps our oldest colleague. But I could give you some examples from the 30s. Parties win elections when people are unhappy. In our system especially, elections get won and lost far more often because they're referendums on what's going on. Bad economies bring bad elections. What Republicans have learned from 1994 and 2010 is, if you make the process look awful, look even worse than it usually is, make it even worse than it looks, you may well win elections as people rebel against what they see as a party in power. That is a good thing if you want to win elections. It is not a good thing if you want to solve problems and govern. And I think that's what's behind Jeb Bush, no raving liberal, being upset about the direction in which his party is going.
Well, all I'll say about Jeb Bush is the Bush family still hasn't gotten over losing in 1980 to Rinaldus Magnus. And I'll leave it at that. I will actually partially agree that a lot has changed since 1990. Actually, I'm going to say since the early 80s, although people didn't start to crystallize their perception of this until the 1990s, and it's this. And you, it came up probably in that famous question in the debate this year of the to the Republican candidates, would you take a tax deal that was $1 of taxes for $10 of spending cuts? And they all raised their hand, no. And on the surface, this is a preposterous idea. Of course, the right answer would have been, you can keep the dollar of taxes, I'll just take the $9 in spending cuts. But no one had the wit to say that. But why was that answer given by the field? Well, it was given because the history of the last 30 years, actually longer than that, but since politics became closer, is that these deals never work for Republicans. They've seen this movie before. How many times did the Republican Charlie Brown have to fall for the Lucy and the football trick? And that explains a lot of the ideological fervency that's much stronger than it was 25, 30 years ago. And I think it explains why you now see the rise of the Tea Party, which I do think is the Republican analog of the anti-war movement in the Democratic Party 35, 40 years ago. It's a very disruptive force, might even tear the party apart. We'll come back to all that. You mentioned the Greg Conrad Commission. On the other hand, I note the president walking away from the Simpson-Bowles Commission. We can play tennis like this all day. Let me just make one other point, and I'll stop, and we can go to audience questions. Give you one other little piece of evidence about why I think the fundamental problem is that the Democratic Party has never gotten over the presumption that they deserve to be the permanent ruling party in America. And this explains some of the symmetry of the ferocity of the political competition. Maybe the best example, and this one's a little old, but I still think it captures it very well. It was right after the 2004 election. Remember all that? Republicans extended their majorities, which they then held for 10 years in the House and 8.5 years in the Senate. In that election, and remember that Tom Daschle was defeated, the majority leader, in part because of the argument that he'd been obstructionist to nominees, right? Well, in comes Harry Reid as the new majority leader, and the New York Times asked for comment from Joe Biden, who said this: "The idea that people are looking at Harry to sort of be a spokesperson of the Democratic Party, that's not a role all majority leaders have filled before." Wait a minute, what did he say, majority leader? They hadn't been in a majority for 10 years. Now, okay, it's Joe Biden, but he is vice president. Or Dianne Feinstein, who I like to call the queen mum of the Democratic caucus, who told the Times in the same article, "If we keep going on this way, we'll be a minority party." Now, this kind of presumption made perfect sense in 1955 or 1965, or even as late as 1985 to a certain extent. It really doesn't make sense after the 1990s. And so one of the things that you see, this is subtext often in sort of liberal writing and liberal analysis, or centrist writing even, is that there's something unnatural about a Republican majority. And I think this adds to the ferocity, quite properly so in some respects, to the Republicans to say, nope, we're not going to kick that football again. So.
Thanks, gentlemen. Well, that was very civil, wasn't it? All right, now I'm supposed to take some questions, but I thought that I would ask each of you one quick question to start off so I can figure out how to do this. And I'll just ask each of you. Norm, I wonder how you'd respond to a political party that has nominated or is about to nominate Mitt Romney as its presidential nominee and 4 years earlier nominated John McCain as its presidential nominee. How does that fit with your idea that this is such a bunch of crazy radicals? And that's part A. And Steve, I thought I'd ask you to address the following point, that what might make the Republicans radical in this day and age? Is their understanding, or maybe Norm might say their misunderstanding, of the legislative process. That the nature of a legislature involves give and take and negotiation and compromise, and that if you listen to many Republicans these days, compromise is a dirty word, and they seem unwilling to compromise. And if that's how they approach the nature of a legislative process, it undermines the institution, the fundamental nature of the institution. Norm, why don't you start, and then Steve?
Sure, and I think the best way to answer that is to look at what McCain and Romney had to do to win nominations and where they are. You know, I worked a lot with John McCain, who has been through much of his career very conservative and a problem solver, somebody who looked for solutions on immigration, on climate change, on campaign finance, and in other areas, and abandoned all of those positions as he moved forward to win a Republican nomination. I look at a Mitt Romney who's taken a position on immigration that has made Sheriff Arpaio and Russell Pierce ecstatic, and a position that I would view as extreme and outside the bounds of our normal politics. A candidate who openly embraces Donald Trump, who even George Will calls a bloviating ignoramus, but who has gone over the line, it seems to me, in terms of some of the things that he said. The other litmus test positions that had to be taken, and when I've talked to John Huntsman, who couldn't even get traction in a presidential contest, partly because of his own missteps, but about the litmus tests that he views candidates now have to take. And once you take those positions, you hold to them. And I don't view Mitt Romney, I view Mitt Romney as somebody who is not just the Etch-a-Sketch guy, but the chameleon. But that doesn't matter. He will move into office if he assumes the presidency and basically be both bound to what he has promised in the past, but also to a legislature that has moved far enough outside, and that includes budget and tax positions that it seemed to me go very far from what we have seen in the past, that would leave him at the edges, whatever his internal beliefs, if they exist.
All right. Steve?
I'm going to speak analytically about this a little bit. I actually think that there's quite a bit to be said that the Republican Party, I'm not sure if it's not understanding the legislative process or isn't very good at it. I have a couple of thoughts on this. One is I think the Republican Party's ability to as a legislative party, atrophied during those decades when they were out of power. And during that period, what do Republicans succeed at? Well, they succeeded in electing presidents, starting with Eisenhower and especially the Nixon era. And even before that, I think you could see that the two parties had a slightly different character, somewhat related to their ideology, but somewhat related to their experience. The Republicans became a more executive-minded party. The Democrats became a more legislative-minded party. They're better at running Congress. There's no question of that. And Republicans have yet to prove that they're any good at governing as a majority. I mean, I thought, and this is sort of a, looking back, a moment that had there been a way to organize or incite the Tea Party, it would have happened earlier. So in 2006, when Tom DeLay says, we can't possibly cut spending anymore, spending's been cut to the bone, you knew the game was up, that there was nothing left of any sort of principled core to conservative Republicanism in running Congress. They'd become a favor factory and an establishment party that was only maybe, actually not even really any better than the Democratic Party from a conservative point of view. So the big challenge for Republicans, if they can win, the only reason they, you know, the Gingrich years, they had Clinton as a foil. So they actually got some things done because that kind of worked in opposition. But they have yet to prove that they can actually govern as a majority party, either in a parliamentary sense or any other. And that's going to be a big test if they happen to win the election.
Okay, we're going to go to questions, but I want to remind people that they can still can either email their questions to AEIdebates at AEI.org or Twitter at hashtag. I've now said hashtag twice today. That is the most times I've ever said hashtag in a 24-hour period.
Your kids are so impressed.
Hashtag AEIdebates. We have a question here that kind of a number of good questions. Let's start off with this one. And I'll add a PS to it. What is the role of the Tea Party, and is it the reason, or how much of the reason at all, that you think that the Republicans are extreme, and how do you think the Tea Party fits into the Republican Party in this whole question of extremism? Why don't we have Steve start?
Well, I already mentioned a little bit that it's, I think it really is for the first time, I don't know, maybe Norm will correct me, but it is a pretty substantial populist movement on the right. You never really saw conservatives out in the streets much over the years. I mean, they do lots of stuff, but actually getting out to do rallies the way the Tea Party did, that was unprecedented.
So they were all in the country club, so.
Well, no, that's, you know.
Kidding, sorry.
Yeah, go there, on. You know, what is that? So there's a, come on, there's got to be a good joke about a country club riot, right? This has been coming for a long time, I think, in a lot of ways. As I said, I'll just dilate the point a bit more. Just as the new left and the anti-war movement and its associated parts pushed the Democratic Party to the left in the 60s and 70s, to the ruination of Johnson in 68, right, and the McGovern and all the, you know, lots of problems. The Tea Party is problematic for Republicans. I happen to like them myself. They're my kind of peeps. But at the same time, as an analyst, you can see, I'll put it to you this way. I was going to say this in my closing, but I'll do it now. One of my ironic criticisms of Norm's book is that they don't actually take its thesis seriously enough in this sense. It seems to me that the real prospect and problem for the Republicans is that they might fracture in two, either for the reasons I was just mentioning or for other reasons. And you might, there was talk of it, would there be a Tea Party candidate this year? Should there be Tea Party candidates challenging for congressional offices and independently, right? And, you know, that would look like something like, not quite the same, but something like the Wallace candidacy in 68, right? And it split the Republican parties. And at that point, I predict that Tom and Norm would look back with fuzzy sentimentality on the prudent leadership of Mitch McConnell and John Boehner.
Norm, could I ask you to comment on the Tea Party, whether you see them extreme? And then I'll ask you a part B, although it's not asked here. Could you then comment on the Occupy Wall Street movement and whether you regard that as extreme?
Sure. And, you know, I think these, let me say, the Tea Party movement is a populist movement, just as the Occupy movement is. It rose during a time, as it usually does, of economic turmoil. Populism is deep in our DNA. It was an attack on leadership and establishment leadership. But I think we often use Tea Party as a kind of shorthand that simplifies things a little bit too much, and it gets to one of Steve's points. The headaches for John Boehner especially, less Mitch McConnell, who I think has been very cold-blooded in his strategy in a way that Boehner hasn't. It was in the House far more than the freshman Tea Party members, the members of the Republican Study Committee, including longtime veterans like Jim Jordan of Ohio and Mike Pence and a number of others who posed a much deeper challenge. But with all of that, a part of the problem was there's a natural tendency when you have this movement emerging and people who are energized to ride that tiger and to exploit it as much as you can and believe that once you have taken them past the finish line, you can co-opt them. And I'll change the animal metaphor. If you cultivate a hungry and rabid Rottweiler and it scares everybody in the neighborhood, that can be fabulous for you until you have to go outside. And then it may not recognize who the master really is. And I think it's been frustrating for a John Boehner, who at root is a legislator and a problem solver, that he can't control his troops. And that's a part of what's going on here. What's also true, and Stu, you know this as well as anybody, having interviewed and talked to candidates who become members, the Tea Party people coming in as freshmen in 2010 viewed themselves as different from the 1994 class, the Gingrich class. What's the difference? We share a lot of ideology, but they went Washington. So if you think the 1994 Gingrich Republicans went Washington, and they compromised, and you're not going to do that, that tells you something about where we are. A word or two on the Occupy movement, which I think also emerged from the same roots in a similar way, but it tells you a little bit of a difference, almost the tribal difference between the two parties. The Tea Party movement was leaderless. It emerged from the bottom up. But they organized. They found candidates. They moved through and into the political process as it was to have an impact, and they did. The Occupy movement has occupied. They're sitting there waiting for something to happen. And they've had an impact, I think, in changing the dialogue, the 1%, the 99% that's out there. And the fact that you even had the publisher of the Manchester Union Leader before the New Hampshire primary saying that he was going to endorse Newt Gingrich and not Mitt Romney because Mitt, nice guy, embodied the 1%, tells you the impact that they've had. But have they had an impact on our politics or on the legislative process? No. Find me one candidate who was recruited as an Occupy Wall Street candidate to run for any office. I haven't found one yet. So there's a real difference, and of course it gets back to why Will Rogers said, I'm not a member of any organized political party, I'm a Democrat.
All right, I have a number of these questions. Our combatants here have already taken a shot at. It's been part of their earlier comments. But I think this is a very direct question, and Norm, we'll start with you on this. Maybe I'll elaborate. The question is simply, doesn't it seem like Democrats are unwilling to meet the GOP halfway? And if I may just add to that, it seems to many, I think, Steve, that the Republicans went more than halfway for much of the last century. They went 80% of the way, 90% of the way, and that now simply the Republicans are sticking up for Republican principles while Democrats are refusing to move at all their way. Comment.
I do think that there is a point to be made that if you're a status quo party and you're a party that doesn't like the status quo, there's some unease that you just continue that status quo. Although we made a point of saying we're talking about a status quo that goes back a century. It's a status quo that started with Teddy Roosevelt and building even some basic regulatory regime that carries through the New Deal, moving back before the Roosevelt era, and we're already starting there. The Gilded Age, the new Gilded Age is upon us, still leaves me with some pause. But I can understand that point. Having said that, I think if you look at, for example, the trajectory of discretionary domestic spending, which is most of government as we know it, it has been both leveled off and declined significantly. Steve talked about how those deals were all so bad and Republicans have been screwed repeatedly. I'll go back to my friend Jeb Bush, who noted the 1990 budget agreement, where you actually got some very significant spending restraint with tax increases. And as conservative Bruce Bartlett has said many times, when you find that you cut taxes, you don't cut spending. When you raise taxes, you do. And that's where we've seen those dynamics at work. I think you do see some significant opportunities here to do more than meet halfway with the Gang of Six plan. And Steve mentioned Simpson-Bowles Commission. I will just note that when President Obama said positive things about the Gang of Six plan and said this is a framework from which we can work, a senior Republican leadership aide in the Senate wrote to Politico and said, well, that kills it. If he's for it, we're against it. So I think we're not seeing that dynamic play out quite the way that some of the critics would have suggested.
Now, this is way too fun. First of all, we should, I think, speak precisely and say ex-conservative Bruce Bartlett. I mean, I don't, anyway. And then Obama saying positive things about the Gang of Six deal. You know, I had a slightly more cynical take on that. That was his way of killing it. given the atmosphere you've described, the quickest way for Obama to kill a deal he doesn't like is to praise it publicly out front. Maybe I'm being too clever and cynical. I don't know. But so here's the problem, to sort of restate it. I'm surprised Norm hasn't brought it up yet. I've actually sort of toyed with the idea that, yeah, maybe we should raise the taxes on the 1% because so many of them vote for Obama and they deserve it. But the more serious part of the theory is that if you want people to want less government, maybe they'll pay for all the government they're getting and they'll want less of it. I think that's the serve the check philosophy. So I'm a bit of an outlier there and no longer welcome at Grover's Wednesday meetings. However, here's the difficulty. What we've seen now under Obama is we have seen the federal government's share of GDP go from its historic range of about 21 to 23% in peacetime up to about 24 to 27, with all the projections of entitlements taking it up over 30 in the years ahead. So there's a ratchet. We've already had this ratchet with Obamacare and the stimulus, which raised the baselines for a lot of programs going forward. And we're told, oh, meet us halfway. That's notwithstanding any reasonableness on my part, or I suspect Boehner and others have said, they're open to higher revenues, not necessarily higher tax rates. That's the old supply side argument. But Obama doesn't want to have that argument. He really is a believer in punitive liberalism that really wants to tax the rich, whether it's economically efficient or pro-growth or not. And that's going to be people are going to have to move off of that if there's going to be any move on the Republican side.
Well, I could give a fairly robust response to that, including that basically if you look at most government other than entitlements, which have been supported by both, that spending has gone down. But the more important point is you've seen a willingness. You know, you can say it's a cynical move by supporting something. When a president says that he is supportive of a plan that makes dramatic cuts in most of government, including Medicare, Social Security, and Medicaid, which is what the Gang of Six plan, endorsed by Tom Coburn, Saxby Chambliss, Lamar Alexander, and Mike Crapo, among others, did, you're going to have a hard time backing away from that. And you have laid down a marker. That's a very different marker than what Republicans other than John Boehner have laid down. As soon as they got to a dime in revenues in the negotiations around the debt limit, Eric Cantor walked out and made it clear that there wouldn't be any negotiations over that sort. And we're now dealing with a world in which there will be some increases overall because we have a population that's aging and living longer. However you want to deal with it, we are going to have some increases in entitlements, although we can curb that rate of growth. But when you've got taxes that are at the lowest level of GDP since the 1950s, the idea that cutting them further will enable you to deal with deficits and debt, I find just bizarre.
Okay, the next question. There are members of the, I get this question all the time when I give speeches. This is one of the classic questions of any speaker. We have members of the media here, so this is a terrific opportunity to beat up on somebody, right? So the question is, and we'll start with you, Steve, and then Norm. How much does the media make the Republican Party look more extreme than they really are? Is this media a factor here or not?
I think it was, there's this quote that went around, I think, in the 2004 election, I think it was Evan Thomas who said the media is worth 15 points to John Kerry. I think that's completely wrong. If that were really true, Republicans would never win. They seem to be able to win despite media criticism or hostility or whatever you want to say. And also, I think what's really fun these days is people, I just watched Robert Reich give a lecture where he talked about, gosh, really like the good old days when we all watched the same network news. And they hate Fox News, right? Well, the media monopoly is over. Right, people get their news from all over the place. That's not without its problems. The criticism that we select the news that we agree with—that's a reasonable criticism. But I think to the extent that media bias was, I think it was really the most egregious in the Goldwater years. Look, if you go back and look at media coverage of Goldwater, it was atrocious. That doesn't happen as much anymore. I mean, I think a lot of it's still pretty bad. You can criticize individual pieces, but I don't tend to play that game much.
Norm, any thoughts?
Yeah, no, of course. Tom and I have written a lot about this. I do think there was substantial liberal bias in the mainstream press in the 1960s. I think there's no doubt about it. I think, of course, our media environment has changed radically. We have a partisan press now that is back to the future, but with much greater reach, depth, and immediacy than we have ever seen before. This is not like William Randolph Hearst. And that has added to our complications because it's creating different sets of facts for people. And if we're going to talk about the media, you have to start with that. When you live in a world where 30 or 40% of the self-identified members of one party believe the president isn't legitimate because he wasn't born in the United States, it tells you something about the way our media dynamic is working. That's left the remaining mainstream press with a bit of a dilemma. And I believe they've solved that dilemma by falling back on an old shibboleth that you report both sides of the story. Whether there are six sides of the story or really one side of the story, you report both sides of the story. So that means if there's a Holocaust denier and a Holocaust victim, you want to give them both sides equally. If there's a hit-and-run driver and a hit-and-run victim, and I don't think it works. It works very well. And among other things, I think it's helped to enable some of the dysfunction we have now. Go back to the filibuster. When you get news stories that say that bills died in the Senate when they got a majority of support and died only because of filibusters, and you don't mention the filibuster, that seems to me to be an inaccurate way of reporting what actually went on. And it means that in the end, however this plays out with either party, you're not holding people accountable for their actions.
Norm, I want to follow up this, and then you get a shot at this. Try to imagine, this might be uncomfortable, but try to imagine Mitt Romney is elected president, the Republicans win the Senate, pick up six seats or something, the House is about the same. Shouldn't we expect the Democrats in opposition to behave just like the Republicans are behaving now? Or do you think that they will be magnanimous, looking to concede the Republican agenda? Are they really going to behave so differently?
It'll be interesting to watch, and I think Democrats are going to say, you did it to us, we'll do it to you. But whether they can work together to do that remains to be seen. But let me give you another scenario that's a little more comparable. Imagine if the Democrats hold the Senate and Mitt Romney becomes president. Do I think at that point the Democrats are going to say, screw you, we're going to behave the way the House Republicans did, we're going to behave as a parliamentary party, block everything, hold everything hostage? No, I think Mitt Romney is going to go to Democrats in the Senate far more frequently than he will to Republicans and say, please help me out here. And I would bet a considerable amount, not $10,000, I don't have that kind of money, but I would bet a considerable amount that he would find plenty of Democrats willing to cut deals with him.
Steve?
One of the problems that Norm and Tom correctly identify in their book is that both parties are now subject to enormous pressures from the outside groups. Now, I didn't develop this argument, I don't have time to, but some of their reforms they've liked over the last 30 years are part of the cause of that. It's their fault that this has happened. But, however, you know, the groups are, so, you know, there exists on the left, that's wild to think of some examples, but the rough equivalent of Grover Norquist's no-touch pledge. There's not a formal pledge type of thing, but the pressures that we brought from organized labor, from certain other groups, for the Democrats to draw a line in the sand is going to be enormous. It's hard to resist these days with independent money and all the way political organizations are established. Sort of end with this point. And so this is one of my arguments with Norm we've had in another domain on political reform in general. You know, Richard Lugar might still have a seat if you had the old robust central party organizations that have been undermined over the years by various campaign finance reform schemes and so forth that have actually you know, diminished the power of central party organizations and increased the power of independent organizations and insurgent groups such that a political party establishment is not very well established anymore and can't come to the rescue of their moderates or long-time, long-serving members.
Probably have time for maybe one or two before closing. Statement. So let me start with you, Steve. This is a question that was asked, and Norm raised the debt ceiling vote or votes earlier. And so somebody asked, was the debt ceiling debate an example of extremism, or do you think that it was an appropriate tool to constrain government?
I'd answer it this way: the fight over the debt ceiling represents the new moment we're in. When Republicans are saying, they've actually become now the sort of Buckley-eyed conservative party yelling, stop, enough is enough. Now, Norm is right, it's a very dangerous thing to do, although I'm not much impressed by credit ratings. So the same people who said Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac were just fine. The downgrade doesn't actually get me terribly excited. The optimist in me thinks that this might prove to be, however the election turns out, that first run of the debt ceiling, which ended pessimistically and is a bit of a train wreck, it might be the fiscal equivalent in the fullness of time of the Reykjavik summit on arms control, which everyone knows ended in failure and gloom and turned out to be the key moment when people came back and said, no, we're going to have to see our way through this. So that's possible, although we may have to go a couple more rounds on all this. And we can play out lots of games about a lame duck session depending on the election results and other matters, but I'll stop there.
Isn't this just a modern version of the game of chicken and the Republicans are playing it better than the Democrats?
I will say I was appalled by what happened with the debt limit, and we've written about this. You don't play chicken with the full faith and credit of the United States. And, you know, it's true. The debt limit, which is a stupid thing to do, first of all, we're one of two countries that does it. You are ratifying previous debts. You're not actually extending it. But it's been a political football ever since we've done this. And if you look at all of the votes over many decades, it's almost funny as you watch the parties exchange their scripts with each other as the presidencies change. And the level of hypocrisy as you stand up and vote against the debt limit and piously say that you're going to stand firm for fiscal responsibility when it's the other guy's president, and then you take the script from the other guy and say, we've got to be responsible here when it's yours. All of that is enough to leave anybody cynical. But the fact is that at every time in the past, the leaders knew that it was a game and they weren't actually going to endanger the full faith and credit of the U.S. And they had votes in reserve if they needed them. Lots of members needed cover so that they couldn't be attacked for voting to increase the debt limit. This was different. I don't hold much truck with ratings agencies, and I view Standard & Poor's as both standard and poor. But when they wrote about this and said, here's another 11th-hour rescue, we've had that before, but the politics of this leave us with no confidence that you're going to be able to manage the future. And then we looked at the debacle that followed with a super committee. Here are the political equivalent of the Avengers, but with kryptonite, and they can't act. And now, Speaker Boehner, who said when he became Speaker, there's some things now we're going to have to behave like adults and be responsible, and that includes the debt limit, leading the charge for another hostage-taking mechanism. It says to me we're operating on dangerous ground here, and we can get away with it as long as there is no other reserve currency and other countries and systems are doing worse than we are, but it's not a game I believe that we should be playing.
This reminds me, I was interviewing a candidate earlier this cycle. I won't say what office he was running for or what state he is from, but we were discussing his position on raising of the debt ceiling and the like. And I said, well, would you really push hard enough so that we would actually go into default? And the candidate, who was, I thought, reasonably bright and articulate and knew something about this area, looked at me and he said, well, you know, yes, because everyone would know it would just be a technical default. I mean, the U.S. government isn't really going to default. It would just be a technical default. And I thought to myself, well, I'm sure the European markets would be very content to say, it's just a technical default. We don't have to worry about that. I don't know whether that's radical, but that is different. Now we're going to go to the point where each of the or gentlemen here will have 5-minute closing statements, and then I'll have a brief conclusion. And we're going to I gather this has been all figured out. We're beginning with Steve with a 5-minute closing statement on the question about whether the Republican Party now is too extreme.
Okay. Well, let me start my timer. It seems to me that you cannot conclude the Republican Party is too extreme when you begin with this very odd premise that Democrats or liberals are merely pragmatic problem solvers. Even as in the case of Obama, they self-consciously use the fundamental rhetoric of large-scale changes. But when conservatives seek changes or reforms, they are being radical or extreme or rolling back the clock. This is a nice way of avoiding having to argue the merits of any issue very closely. I think it's a species of lazy historicism. But I think we should step back and avert our gaze for a moment from some of the particulars of the hypothesis that we've discussed tonight, including some of the reforms. We didn't get into some of the reforms that Norm suggests of reforming the filibuster, or some voting reforms, and so forth, which I think would make very little difference, actually. But I think I want to step back for a moment again and look at this from the summit, so to speak. Everyone ought to put on the top of their reading list this week an article that appears in the New Criterion current issue called The Fourth Revolution. You can find it at newcriterion.com. The author, Jim Pearson, makes a challenging argument that I think may be correct. He says we're on the cusp of a fourth great political revolution in America, the successor to the party revolutions of 1800, 1860, and 1932. That brought a whole new order to our governance. Usually that was through a new party becoming a dominant and long-lasting majority. It could be that this fourth revolution is already underway. We can see the results from Wisconsin last week. Now, political scientists will recognize this as a variation of the classic realignment theory as described most famously by Sam Lubell. But in the present case, the salient fact is this. What Walter Russell Mead calls the blue state model of governance is irretrievably broken. We're not just looking at some growth of entitlements. We're looking at extraordinary growth that would be multiple sizes, multiple times the gross GDP in another 30 or 40 years. It seems that some state-level Democrats get this. You see Democrats in San Jose, San Diego, Chicago, the mayor of Chicago, the governor of New York, the Democratic legislator of Rhode Island, that seem to get this, although I think national Democrats don't seem to know it yet. Pearson argues, I think compellingly, that even if Obama is reelected in November, increasingly he and his ideology are going to look like the last gasp of a dying era of governance, putting him in the same ranks as John Adams, James Buchanan, and Herbert Hoover, as the heralds of an end of an age. Now, this is why I say that to suppose that the clash of the parties that's been described here could be diminished or ameliorated through process reforms, I think takes optimism to a whole new level. And as I said a few moments ago in extemporaneous comments, I actually think that the thesis that Norm lays out ought to be taken more seriously. I mean, I think that the problem of democratic stability has been taken too much for granted, and the prospects for instability have been too much banished from our mind by the great success of post-war democracies here and in Europe. I think it is not impossible that 6 months from now, Greece could be governed by a military government, or that Spain could ask for help from NATO in keeping order in its streets if its unemployment goes to 40% because of the gathering storm on the continent. Now, our prospects are not nearly as dire, despite Norm cleverly suggesting that the Republicans might be extremists in the same way that Holocaust deniers were extremists. We're more stable than that, but I do think there's some prospect of the Republican Party breaking up, unless it holds together for its principles. If it becomes another Me Too party again, then they'll just be cut up by the Tea Party, and what's the use of a Republican Party that does that anyway? And that is why I'll repeat what I said earlier and include on this note. If that prospect comes along, Norm will, as I say, look back with fuzzy, warm feelings for John Boehner and Mitch McConnell, and at that point, Stu, you can pass the airsick bag to Norm and the last word.
Steve is, of all things, moving to California, and we won't go into that, but I would also note that Steve has been somewhat of an apostate within the conservative movement in his own party, and we quote liberally and quite favorably from pieces that he's written trying to rein in a conservative movement. And we also have in Steve somebody who takes a very conservative position on climate change but acknowledges there may be a problem, which has resulted in him being ostracized by many as well. So I have a lot of sympathy for him in what he's trying to do. I am uneasy about the future. I don't believe we're going to see the emergence of a new majority. I think we are an evenly divided country. I think a large part of the problem that we have is not structural, it's cultural right now. And moving beyond that, and moving beyond a kind of tribal politics, back to something where we view the tribe in a larger sense and look towards problem solving is going to be difficult to do. And as much as anything, our book is a lament about the decline of problem solving. And as I look over the trajectory of the last few years and think about the entitlement state, and think about the reality that reining in the costs and size of government comes down fundamentally to healthcare costs, and that we didn't have two parties playing to rein in healthcare costs. Repeal and replace is basically repeal, and we'll talk about it later. When I think about Medicaid, the single largest component of it is long-term care for the elderly. And we're looking at a population that, as I said and you know, is getting older and people living longer. Long-term care is going to be a huge problem. We fund it largely through Medicaid. Anybody who really believes that if you just cut it 30% and give it to the states, they're going to find a formula for taking care of the elderly in nursing homes that goes beyond moving from one nurse's aide for every 5 patients to one for every 25 patients is simply deluding themselves. But have we had or has there been any willingness to sit down and discuss how either liberals or conservatives can figure out a way for the society to deal with the problem that people are going to have with their parents and grandparents down the road. These are problems that, whether you are liberal, conservative, or anything else, need to be resolved. They're not going to be resolved entirely by government, but government is going to play a role, and we are no longer at a point where we can even have a conversation on those things. How we move to that point remains an enormous challenge for us. It's a challenge for both parties. I worry about a Democratic Party that over time may well itself become more extreme or more liberal. It has moved, as we have said in our jargon, probably on the whole to about the 25-yard line, using the football field analogy, while I believe the Republican Party has basically moved beyond its own goalpost. But you can imagine a Democratic Party that loses almost all of the remaining elements of its moderate and conservative movement, and that decides more and more to dig its heels in. I do not think that's happened, and I think some of the rhetoric has been kind of ridiculous. A Democratic Party that took all the reins of power and didn't enact card check or any of the labor wish list items, that came up with a health care plan that not only didn't do single payer but didn't include a public option. The idea that this is the secular socialist machine that Newt Gingrich called it, or that this is an administration and a Democratic Party that, as Herman Cain said just the other day, consciously, deliberately is trying to destroy capitalism, I find a little bit ridiculous. But you can imagine both parties moving further apart and leaving those traditional conservative Jeb Bush-type Republicans with no easy place to go. I do not think a third party is going to emerge. Our system and our culture won't tolerate that. But we're going to have to find some way to get back to a culture of problem solving, or the rest of the country may end up looking like California squared.
I'd like to thank Steve and Norm for a terrific debate, during which...
Wait.
Well, you're going to hold on, stay right there, during which they showed their great intellect and civility. I would like to note that this and other debates are available at aei.org, and transcripts are also available at the site. I'd like to note that Norm's book will be available for purchase after we adjourn. Norm, show me, can I see this book here? Here it is. It's even worse than it looks. And finally, before we adjourn, please look at these two gentlemen. The title of this book is It's Even Worse Than It Looks. Look at them. They're even better than they look. We're adjourned. Thank you very much.